chưa đề là sẽ đem ra cả bay đến Singapore nên là nếu các anh chị có câu hỏi này dành cho giáo sư thì tranh thủ hỏi trong giờ này.
So, thank you very much. All right, so that's my last chance today to thank Lynn and the whole that organized. It's been wonderful meeting, city of pleasure, going to find around with you, it's been really great. Great people in the room. Again, many thanks, wonderful translation. I mean, from being on this side, I see faces. Some guys are interested, some guys are very interested, some guys are sleeping. The one who was 100% engaged is Mwen. I saw her eyes all the time, all the time, all the time. Wonderful job, thank you very much. All right, so, did you translate that, Mwen? I didn't hear it, I didn't hear it. You're too modest. All right, so, I will just talk briefly about optic atrophy. And I'll start with a conclusion. Right, so optic atrophy, the most important thing is your history. Optic atrophy, something bad has happened that you ignore. To understand why. It's not antibodies or OCDs. I'm going to give you the solution. And there is one rule, and that's my main message. Every optic atrophy deserves imaging. And that will never be a debate. Now, because, I'll come back to that. 20% of patients with unexpected optic atrophy have a tumor. Yet, you still have to consider inflammation, ischemia, toxic nutritional, and look at genes,
genetic testing.
I have to say that I'm seeing quite often, I'm sure that you guys are the same, patients who are sent to us, the typical situation is famous cataract surgeon, don't look great, operating on a patient, getting his cataract out, patient not recovering, and then there's optic atrophy. These patients are sent to us saying, oh, what happened? The patient is not happy. The cataract was too dense to be able for me to assess the optic nerve. That's true. Right, so when you're dealing with optic dysatrophy, this is a non-specific sign. When you're seeing that, I have no idea what happened there. It's just like seeing a skeleton. You have no idea why that bird died. So, number one, when you're dealing with optic atrophy, rule out imaging. So, this is a nice study done by Andrew Lee, Michael Wall, around a couple of good guys. They look at patients with no unexplained optic atrophy. 20% of that had some explanation with imaging. I think 20% is a lot. You cannot afford missing that. This is a patient who had optic neuritis, but did not recover after steroids. Well, we did a new imaging. Anybody idea what's wrong? What's wrong? Anything wrong? Anything wrong with this interview? Believe we have to start all this again. Anything wrong? Children, for instance, who have NF1, they may not complain of visual loss, yet they have those gliomas. In fact, optic atrophy can be due to any optic neuropathy. But the ones you are interested in is the one that you can cure. You cure it, good. Yeah, you have to consider all the optic neuropathies we've been talking about during those 2 days. Just a quick word of optic disc cupping. What is the most common cause of optic disc cupping? Glaucoma, right? Yet glaucoma is not the only cause. There are other causes of optic nerve cupping. And compression is one of them, again, a curable cause. I still see 2 to 3 cases of so-called normal tension glaucoma who have been caused by a meningioma or a twitter or whatever. Let me show you a great case. What I read in is temporal pallor, the discs are pale. No diabetic retinopathy. Refer to neuro off for opinion. How easy is that, right? That's the whole thing. Right?
I'm
glad you told me. It's not only to you, it happens to all of us, exactly. So the story is, this is a young man. No past medical history, and vision is low on both sides. Ishihara is down, now we're okay. What does that tell you? Do you do Ishihara on a very everyday basis? Or will you feel there's a neuron? No. Oh, who has access to Ishihara in the room, please? One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. That's not enough. It should be 100%. Guys, that's a simple thing. It takes you 1 minute. Ishihara is a testing for congenital blindness. Right? Yet, it's great because if it's abnormal, it tells you a lot about the possible outcome of their disease. start from scratch. Do you know what a shiara is? Who knows what a shiara is? Please. Who has never heard? Please be frank. Who has never heard of the word shiara? One, two. Three, four. Okay, guys, that's very important. I think this is probably the most important message we can have here today. Forget about active gas phase and stuff. Ishihara, start with that. You have an application on iPhone. Look at Ishihara. It's written I-S-H-I-R-A, Ishihara. Just look at color vision. Ishihara now, that means probably there's either something magenta, as you can be aware, or not being blocked. Ishihara, can we make you distinguish between ischemic and inflammatory, to answer your question? Ishihara is down in inflammatory, quite reserved in ischemic, or marginal volume. Right. So Ishihara down can be the genital there. If somebody loses, if it takes you one minute to test the Ishihara. I mean, for your familiar with Ishihara, right? Yes. Okay. And this is fundoscopy, optic atrophy. So this patient has bilateral optic atrophy, middle off. What is the first thing you're going to order? IOP. We have that already. 22-24. But that's what else do you order? Visual field, exactly, that's what you want to know. Right, okay, let's say this is quite, no, it's still feasible. This is, okay, let's say central scotoma. What do you do now? I'm sorry? Genetic testing. But what if it's a tumor? Right, so I think the next thing to do, absolutely, is an MRI. Genetic later, if MRI is normal. Yeah, so he had an MRI which was normal, sorry. And this is the term visual fields. What does it tell you? Nothing much. MRI normal, and we did what this gentleman was suggesting, genetic testing. We looked at the genes and labors. This mutation is detected. The problem with this mutation doesn't mean anything. But it's hard to say.
Test medication. Paul.
Absolutely right, and there are other things. Look at toxic nutritional. Absolutely. Nutrition. Vegans have been described. Vegans have been described with severe optic neuropathy, as you know. But this guy, because of this, he was known to have labors because this mutation was there, and I'll come back to that. The problem is that he also has a brother who has labors. I'm sorry, who is blind, I'm sorry, he has a brother who is also blind. Is that compatible with labors? Can two brothers have labors? Yes, absolutely, absolutely. And then, one of the brothers said, oh, but you know what? It's funny because our father is also blind. Is that believers? Is that believers? No way. No way. There are little things that are so strongly now in medicine than this one. A kid with labor cannot have labor from that. If he has labor, it comes necessarily from his mother. Yeah, a patient with labors, a kid with labors, he never had that disease from his father. It's necessarily from his mother. Because labor is a mitochondrial disease, and you have all your mitochondria from your mother. Zero from your father. And you cannot have labor from your father. So these boys are having labor possibly both. Yet their father is blind as well. So now we get a question, is this labor? And the answer is no, never, impossible. In medicine, there's always never say never. But in this case, you can say never. In 2018, there is no such thing as labor constrained by a father. So, what was it? It was, in fact, dominant optic atrophy, which is another hereditary optic
problem.
And that mutation that was seen there was just noise. Right, so in labor, there are three main mutations that are known. This is the most common. Unfortunately, also with a poor prognosis. And remember the mutation that was seen on that paper was not among those. The mutation in the kid, right, that we saw, it's not one of those three. This is the typical case of a patient, a young man, is losing vision in one eye. No pain. If there is a painful visual loss, that's never hereditary. It's almost always inflammatory. Very rarely ischemic. But never hereditary. How is this called? This visual field effect? Psychosotoma, thank you. One eye. Vision is down. And then after 3 months, this is the other eye. And the patient is blind. Give me a couple of other causes of central sotoma, please. Other causes of central sotoma. AMD. AMD. Yeah, but you see that. Give me other causes. Central serous, I agree. Central serous for retinopathy. Somebody said? Any other medical problem, let's say. What else? Optic neuritis, thank you very much. What else? You said it before. Nutritional?
Yes, maybe.
Nutritional, toxic, absolutely. So those are things that you take into consideration. Now, the fundus, I think you would agree. the systems be wet and swollen. It's not true. This swelling is pseudo swelling, as you heard before. And this is what labor is. Typically, it's a young male, but again, it's rapidly progressive. Can be bilateral, but usually sequential. One eye and then the other. There are few things in medicine that you can predict 100%. And that's one of them. If one patient has optic labor in one eye, you will have 100% in the other eye. In 90% of cases within the first 6 to 8 months. Color vision, again, that's Ishihara. That's what the kid has to do with the So, bilateral involvement in a few months. So, there are some few prognostic factors, I'm not sure that's very important. What's more important, so this is another kid who lost vision in one eye. By the way, what are you looking when you're looking at the visual field? You have to pick only one word. That one? Huh. See that? Is that what you're looking at? Show us what we're looking at.
Okay. So when you look at the visual fields, so go through a systematic first means a 30-2, make sure it's a reliable test. This is where I put my coffee cup. This is where I work.
Right. So, this is for the family. Explain the family, the grandpa, what's happening. But for your knowledge, it's this. It's the individual deviation, right? Deviation. Don't look at this. I sometimes look at those numbers here, but this is what Celia is saying. We're neurons, right? All right. And then he develops the second eye involvement. Is this fundus is normal? Could this be labors? What do you think? It is labors. She thinks this is labors. The problem, I agree with her, the problem, I'm sorry, this is in French, so Dom will understand this. Don't wake up in the back. She's sleeping. So, there's absence of those three mutations. Can this still be labors? Yes, because those three mutations cover only 95% of situations. So, and we look, we did a complete mitochondrial gene sequencing. And we found this mutation. And these are the 14 mutations in mitochondrial disease that are acceptable. And the three I was talking about are those here. Now there are a few mysteries in labors. Why do they affect the optic nerves and nothing else? Or rarely something else, although mitochondria are everywhere. Why is the penetrance so variable? Why at that age? Why more men than women? Nobody knows, really. Why that age? And I was talking about that earlier. We published a patient, age 87, who had labors. And labors can happen at any age. Labors can also affect other things than vision. Rarely, 10%, 20%. And it's called labor plus. Right. Treatment? I think this is the treatment. Idebenone, if it's early, I don't think we have time to talk about that, but Idebenone, can be. Especially at early stages. The second other optic neuropathy that causes optic atrophy is dominant. This is Mr. Kjær in Denmark who described the disease in 1959. He was so smart, he was much smarter than genetics. He knew and understood. This must be a dominant disease, very different from labors, everything different from everything else. And I had the chance to be interested in Denmark on those cases. What do you think? What's the visual acuity of this patient? This is a patient? What do you think is the vision? Maybe normal, he says. Do you agree with that?
No.
No, why not? I should show the deviation, the visual deviation. But even with this, I would say nothing really obvious. I don't know, Celia, what would you say? It's not the right visual deviation.
I cannot comment unless I see a pattern deviation. And this is a 30-2, but you can definitely see that just based on the grayscale, the central areas has got a slightly different grayscale, which makes me quite suspicious.
But you don't expect 0-1 vision, do you?
No. This is a black spot in glass. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
There we go. But not the big, ugly, dark area. There's something wrong, but to me not compatible 0-1. And we see those patients who are suspected to have functional visual loss. Yet, when you're looking at the discs, you believe that there's something wrong in the area. So the gene in dominant optic atrophy is the OPA1 gene. I don't think it's interesting for you. But this is interesting for you. Usually, it's a different story. Kids usually are having low vision, unexplained. They cope well. Even sometimes, late in life, I have a couple of patients. I remember one of them who is blind, legally blind, yet his wife is not aware of it. He just tells his wife that he doesn't like cars, that's why he doesn't drive. But that's probably one of the only diseases when patients have very low vision and they just cope very well with it. Males and females are equally affected. There is optic dysmetry. And you can have other symptoms like hearing loss. That's a paper we wrote in the brain a couple of years ago. But there are other neurological symptoms as well. So what do we care? Well, in France, we looked at a series of 1,000 patients with unexplained optic atrophy. 1,000 patients, that's a lot. So all those were carefully excluded: glaucoma, nutritional, compression. And we look only at those with unexplained optic atrophy. And guess what? We did a very comprehensive genetic examination. And we found mutations in almost half of the cases. ADOA is far more common than LHON. Now, what's very interesting is that in our LHON cases,
you have now?
Almost half of them have no family history. Now, I remember a study with Lee and Gui that you presented a couple of years ago. There was zero family history. You heard that?
Yes.
How many cases? Can you comment on this? Tell us the story about your story, by the way.
Maybe 30 cases.
30 cases?
Yeah.
Right, so I'll come back to my conclusion. Which is history is the most critical thing. Compression, always think of compression. Don't do genetic testing if you don't have scanners. Consider all those things which are very often overlooked, as you said, you are right. And look at genes. And that's pretty much it. Thank you very much. And I would very like to be with you this afternoon, so I would like to thank you for those wonderful 2 days. It's been a big pleasure. Thank you very much. Questions? Lunch?
So I just want to comment a little bit. You said about the labor hereditary disease. With the two sons have blind.
Correct.
And the father is blind too.
Yeah, that's
so
not
I good. I just think that maybe the father maybe he has the labor too, but
impossible.
Maybe the disease yourself. Maybe he has labor and his wife has labor too. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. It's red.
You are right, absolutely. Yeah. You are so right. You are so right. You are so right. I've seen similar cases. People going to blind schools, and they get together and they double their risk for blind disease. You are absolutely right. Yes, absolutely.
Questions. So we would like to have some recommendation for young resident about how to approach in case of the unilateral of atrophy compared to bilateral of
atrophy. Oh, yeah. Same thing. Image first, hereditary, forget it. Compression, ischemia, inflammatory. Nutrition, toxic, hereditary, forget it. It's either compression or
inflammation.
Right. What I think that it's interesting is that it might be interesting also to have a more systematic approach, how to examine a patient, the neural examination. That Ishihara thing, that broke my heart. How to do a visual field, tangent screen, neuro-ophthalmology. I think those are critical things, which are very well known here and taught here in this center. Okay, thank you very much.
I have something to say. In Vietnam, I want to know your experience in your country. In Vietnam, if the patient comes with a loss of vision,
right. Or
eye, maybe optic atrophy,
right. We
have to rule out the tuberculosis treatment.
Absolutely.
Tuberculosis treatment.
TB.
Yeah, it's ambulatory.
Oh, yeah, that's toxic. Absolutely.
So you have to ask the patient about treatment of TB. Maybe they will not tell you about that.
Yeah, absolutely. They would, I agree. So, right, and talking about TB, I think it's a very important subject. It's not TB itself, it's a family cause. Tramadol, there is a toxic dose, which is anything about 20 milligrams per kilogram per day. 20 milligrams per kg per day. Right? And the Tramadol is a 600 milligrams tablet. And I see patients who are, very thin patients, especially in Vietnam. There might be some old grandmother thing. It could be, overdosed. I see them all the time in Singapore, I have to say. Stop the treatment as soon as you can. If the patient does not recover, the patient should recover a little bit at the beginning, if it's early. The second most dangerous treatment in the same patients is isoniazid, which can also be toxic. Ethambutol and isoniazid, which is also medication in the same patient. So be ready to stop that one as well. The problem with ethambutol is it's a zinc chelator. It stops the zinc from the metabolism. And copper. There are no strong studies about this, but supplement those patients with zinc and copper. And if you do not recover, look at genes. When I see patients not recovering after stopping ethambutol, boom, neighbors. So ethambutol interferes with mitochondria. So ethambutol was just triggering the neighbor. Right, very good remark, yes. Yeah, nothing I said, there is nothing specific when it comes to atrophy, nothing. Central scotoma, right? Now, how can you pick it up early? There's no consensus, there is no nothing. I think that OCT is not a good tool. Multifocal ERG might be a good one. But I understand you don't have multifocal ERG here. So the best you can do is still color vision. Color vision, visual field effects. Right. Nothing specific. Right. This is a terrible disease, that's clearly something iatrogenic.
Screening protocol for ethambutol in this country because TB is quite prevalent. Do you guys see them 3 monthly, 6 monthly, or monthly?
We don't. There is no nothing. In the UK, there has been a consensus. I've been combined, but we've beaten that. And the conclusion was don't do anything. It's rare, it's very rare. There are no strong detection methods. Sensitivity is very low. So people prefer not to do it in the UK. Singapore is saying.
Because there are some doctors from Jerry Hospital, they are thinking about doing the OCT to measure the increase of the RNFL in case of the patient using the ethambutol.
Right, that's a good question. But the problem, this doesn't work like in glaucoma. You have more structural damage first, and then you have the visual field followed. I think for toxic, it's probably the other way around. I suspect, but there is no strong data. The function should be fine.
Stress a very important point that David has mentioned, which is go back to the basics. And yesterday, if I talk, do you remember how when we talk of kidney writers, I said I was 5 things for optimal function, and I showed you the various visual fields that can go on in a person with optic neuritis. The same thing happens in any optic nerve disease, and that's why there were so many slides. It can go from central scotoma, central cecal, altitudinal, and even quite a constricted visual field. But most importantly, whenever you approach with a patient, do those five things: your visual acuity, visual field, RAPD, color vision, subjective brightness. And then you can then think, okay, what's the most common? In a person who is 20 years old, sequential loss of vision, compared to a person who is 60 years old on PP medication for 6 months, your differential would be very different. And your imaging as well as your investigation and all are different. So the whole thing about neuro-ophthalmology is, number one, where is the problem? Okay. Is it in the optic nerve? Is it in the retina? Number two, what is the problem? Is it compressive, infiltrative, genetic, toxic, nutritional? And then you can do the now what? What can I do about that? So neuro-ophthalmology, in simple terms, where, what, and now what?
And sometimes so what?
Yeah, very good. And I think from way that there's a group who's interested in using OCT to look at monitoring ethambutol toxicity. There can be studies that are done and they're also reported. Now, one very important thing I would like to say is that I use OCT all the time, but just like how it was shown yesterday, a lot of times the OCT people do that before they actually look at the optic nerve. Okay. So, and I can see that when I was talking about, you know, a lot of people were taking photos. So there's actually a lot of things you can get just from using your 90D, look at the optic nerve yourself, because the OCT will not show you, the OCT will then spit out the diagnosis. And also another thing is that everybody, when they look at the OCT, they look at the optic nerve plot and to see if they're swelling or not. But please don't forget that it is not a single answer. Just like in this study, which was the one that brought a lot of people into the study, it's not just the nerve fiber layer thickness, it's actually, you have to correlate it with other results in optic nerve function as well.
Thì xin hỏi một câu là thỉnh thoảng mình có gặp những cái bệnh nhân bị cao huyết áp, rồi nó có những thỉnh thoảng có những cái mù thoáng qua do spasm, thì những cái trường hợp đó thì rất là có nhiều nguy cơ phát bệnh mạch chúng ta cũng mạnh cái mù. Thì những trường hợp đó ngoài cái mình điều trị huyết áp cho tốt thì mình có cái biện pháp gì điều trị để ngăn ngừa cái tắc động mạch trung tâm bổn mạch không? Ví dụ như các bạn biết là khi mà tắc rồi trung tâm bổn mạch gặp tiêu rồi. À, thứ hai là chăm sóc thỉnh thoảng nó nói là có cái biện pháp thở qua đi lông á. Ví dụ nó mờ cái là thở qua đi lông để nồng độ CO2 nó cao, nó giãn mạch thì có thể giúp cho bệnh nhân nó giống như là một cái biện pháp điều trị cấp cứu. Và thì tha có còn ở những trường hợp như vậy thì mình có khuyên bệnh nhân thế nào và phòng ngừa ra sao?
So there are two questions asked. The first question is that why is it that in a person who has malignant hypertension getting transient loss of vision? Now, I'll go back to... Okay, now, I practice how I preach, okay? So, remember this diagram I showed you yesterday is when you have optic nerve swelling, one very important thing to think about is a systemic. Okay. Sorry that it's not projecting well. So this is a person who has malignant hypertension, he's a kidney patient, renal patient. Whenever you have optic nerve swelling, the blood supply in the middle is already quite pressed. And so anything that further presses on the artery to reduce the blood perfusion makes you have transient loss of vision. So very commonly whenever someone has optic nerve swelling, one of the things is, do you get lots of vision when you cough, sneeze, go to the bathroom? Okay. Because the nerve is already pressed, you just press a little bit more, it cuts off the blood supply. And that applies not just to hypertension, which is a very good question, it applies to any optic nerve swelling. And once you treat the condition, your optic nerve swelling settles down, there are no longer at the, there's no pressure on your optic nerve, so then the transient visual observation settles down. Okay. Now CRIO is my little pet topic, did a whole PhD on that, okay. The treatment for CRAO, number one, two out of three people at the onset of central retinal artery occlusion did not realize they have vascular risk factor. So two out of three people did not realize they have high blood pressure or they have a cholesterol problem or diabetes. And in fact, some people didn't even realize they have significant carotid stenosis. Back to that thing, whenever you have the first vascular event, it's like a warning sign that we need to check everything to make the modifiable risk factors better. So on the topic of prevention, that is what we can do to prevent, which is actually check the blood and all that. In CRL, the more interesting thing is that everyone is talking about how do you treat it acutely, but I divide my treatment as acutely, people are trying things, but number one, you need to prevent it happening again, and number two, you need to treat local complications. So in CRL, there's also a risk of neovascularization. And I think those two things we can do, we can follow them up, make sure they don't get high pressure neovascularization, and we can make sure that we correct their high blood pressure diabetes.
Yeah, just a quick comment. A quick comment, you showed the slide of OCT, that OCT on an antidote, that Saloon paper is here. Yeah, so I think that you also have to be able to be critical in what you're reading. That is a paper reporting two patients. Wow, this one? Two patients, look it up, three lines. Put it back. Vision one, vision two, and controls. We're talking screening thousands of patients. I'm sorry, but it's no proof. It's a great paper, but it's a story.
Gracias.